Hi, everyone. Good morning. This is Prashant here, co-founder of Snapper, and welcome to our Libra's webinar today. Okay, guys. So the agenda today is basically to have a quick introduction about Libra. What is Libra blockchain? A bit from technical perspective, and how the Libra currency and the reserve works, and how the Libra Association works, and who controls the Libra Association, and followed by a quick conclusion. So before we begin, a quick introduction about Snapper. So we are a leading blockchain technology innovation company. We have been in the blockchain space since 2016 and been awarded as most promising blockchain startup for consistently 3 years. And we provide all end-to-end blockchain consulting services, your solution design application. In case you're looking forward to build an application and you want to understand how you can, you know, fit in the blockchain and how it will fit, we can help you to design the entire solution and also develop that possibly. And our works have been, you know, covered by from Forbes to Times of India to Wall Street Journal, I mean, all leading media across the world. And before we, you know, begin, I would like to give you a quick introduction about what is blockchain, since we have some friends who might be new to this. So I just want to make sure that we are pretty much on the same page.
Okay, cool.
So blockchain is a technology of trust. And how blockchain works is that right now, so there have been three different eras of internet: web 1.0, web 2.0, and the way we are moving is web 3.0. So web 1.0 was all about to use internet for communications. Web 2.0 was all about where we are in today's internet of interaction. And web 3.0 is about internet of value. So traditionally, we actually rely on certain middlemen such as banks or such as lawyers or such as insurance companies to kind of establish trust. And these guys, to establish trust, they take, you know, money, and to move assets, they basically verify the transaction record. So the whole idea, what they do is to monitor the asset transfers across a business network or across a business ecosystem, right? And in Web 3.0 with blockchain, since all the assets can be digitally tracked, digitally trained, and serves as a universal single ledger of truth, right? And the whole idea is that as our business networks and the businesses become more and more complicated, you know, even if a small use case of supply chain, you know, parties A records, parties B records, auditors, regulators, insurance company records are not connected with each other, books are not shared with each other, though we have SAP and all other traditional technologies in place, there's an always issue of trust. Now the challenge is, how would you connect everybody onto a same data record or to a same version of truth at the same time maintaining their security and the privacy? So the answer is blockchain. So with blockchain, we are able to move asset transfers across a business network. We are able to see how you know, the entire audit trail of the record. We have all the access control, and at the same time, we have the highest amount of security as well. And all the parties are connected onto a same version of truth, it becomes very easy for everyone to kind of, you know, verify the transaction. And most importantly, it would bring the efficiency as well. So think of blockchain as a single source of truth or a magical book of records, which is keeping all your transactions related to data. So it is purely about data computing. And it blockchain lies basically at the core of your data level. And so to conclude, NetNet, blockchain is built on your basic business network and business concepts. So in a business transaction in any business world, you have business network, you have multiple participants, you have contracts, you have assets, which could be your data or which could be your money or which could be a set of transactions. And also you maintain a ledger, which is a book of records. So blockchain connects everyone onto a same system, and it enables them to also manage their contracts smartly using smart contracts. So smart contracts are self-executable contracts on which would execute a transaction based on certain parameters. So let's say if you define a contract like A needs to make a payment to B if, you know, the goods reaches from X location to Y location. So traditionally, to monitor this, you need to have a lot of manual intervention, and there's a lot of conflicts and things like that. But the same thing is on the blockchain. As soon as the goods is reached from, you know, A to B, and it is verified by the receiver party, the transaction gets settled or the payment gets settled automatically. So similarly, in a business network and business scenario, there are so many contracts which would require a lot of contractual management and which would, you know, enable efficiency. So ultimately, what blockchain offers to the enterprise is, one is that it connects the business network into a connected ecosystem, thereby bringing efficiency, because all the participants are sharing the single version of truth, meaning everybody has access to the same data. There is no manipulation. There is no tamper-proof of the data, resulting in higher transparency. And most importantly, with smart contracts, the reliability and a lot of middlemen could be get reduced, because your transaction gets executed automatically. And most importantly, how the asset would flow across a business network and how the network or a business network would work, there is a consensus, there is set rule of records. So consensus is basically is a governance on how this business or business network or how this ecosystem would operate. And this would be any uniform for everyone. This is a governance, more of a governance and more of rules and regulations. So this would establish trust, meaning all the participants across the ecosystem have the same or the similar consensus. And most importantly, immutability in the transaction. So once the transactions are recorded on the blockchain, it cannot be manipulated and, you know, tampered with. So let's say if you want to add a separate transaction, you need to always create a new transaction based on the hash of the or the reference of the previous transaction, resulting in a higher security. And most importantly, this universal ledger and distributed ledger is not only decentralized, but it also serves as a single version of truth. So traditionally, before on the internet, it is not possible to have your you know, data trail, basically your audit trail of your data. And with blockchain, you know, this data as an asset, the ownership can be assigned and the movement can be monitored. And, you know, that is why that is this is one of the biggest benefits of blockchain, because since we move from Web 2.0, which is all about Internet of Interaction, to Web 3.0, which is all about sharing Internet of Value. And on the Internet, what we have, our biggest value is our data and data and data. So this is where, you know, blockchain would play a key and a very fundamental role. And as per, you know, Sir Tim Berners-Lee, who is the founder of Internet, he believes that blockchain revolution could be as big as the Internet or probably bigger. So as a company, we offer several enterprise-grade blockchain solutions, right from your supply chain to e-governance, healthcare, and banking. We have worked with a lot of governments in the past. So coming to our agenda of today, which is Libra. So Libra's mission is to be a simple global currency and a financial infrastructure that empowers billions of people. So what do we understand is that if we I just want to play a quick video, you know, before we, you know, start. I hope now you can all see my screen. So just let me play a quick video for you. So the biggest problem what Libra is trying to address here is that there is still a lot of people around the world, around, you know, 1.7 billion people around the world, maybe in the underdeveloping countries, such as, you know, Africa, which doesn't have access to the global financial system. And most importantly, you know, moving money around these countries is expensive because the banks, you know, kind of take very high commission charges and don't serve these geographies because of very high currency fluctuations. So if you try to, you know, understand countries like Zimbabwe, Zaire, even Venezuela, you know, the currencies of these countries, like, you know, keep on fluctuating, and you have $1 billion and a zillion dollar notes and whatnot. So it becomes very difficult for people to have their even basic necessities fulfilled because of a primary issue related to money. And also people in the US alone itself lose more than $40 billion in cash because of movement of cash. And there is a lot of people who are even unbanked and don't have access to basic financial services and ecosystem. So Libra wants to basically create a universal financial infrastructure that could power billions, and everybody can have access to the, you know, common financial system.
Remember when these were fast? And these? Technology has improved the world around us. So why is it simple to send one of these anywhere in an instant, but not money? What if we made money truly global, stable, and secure? What if everyone was invited to the global economy with access to the same financial opportunities? Introducing Libra, a new global currency designed for the digital world, backed by the belief that money should be fast for Ope in Lagos, simple for Saul's family business in Manila, and secure for Betsabe when sending money home to Mexico City. Powered by blockchain, making it safe and accessible. No matter who you are or where you're from. So join us as we move towards a world where money works for everyone. This is Libra, and it's just the beginning.
So they want to make money accessible to everyone and eliminate all the middlemen. So if you try to understand the way money moves today, is that we, you know, rely maybe on SWIFT, maybe a lot of other middlemen when the money has to move from a person A or a country A to a country B. And all these middlemen basically take a lot of transaction cost, which makes movement of money more expensive. And sometimes the money movement or sending money could cost as high as, you know, about 7 to 10%, and also a lot of time, maybe, you know, a week to 10 to even 15 days. So all these problems could be accessed by Libra because they are eliminating everyone and connecting everybody onto a same platform or to on the same ledger. So money is all about bookkeeping and ledger keeping. And the job of all the banks and the middlemen in movement of money is to keep right records and books. And their job is to verify whether there is a sufficient balance available or not. And all these things could be managed in an automated way by a blockchain, and could reduce fluctuation risk as well in movement of money because it enables the transaction and the movement of money almost in real time. So this is where the Libra plays a very key role, because they want to create a financial inclusion for the whole world. So let's try to, you know, understand the history of money. You know, we started, you know, before 600 BC, we started from bartering system where a person exchanged, or people exchanged, some grains for some cattle, right? And the biggest problem with this system was that for a money to be money, it has to be rare, it has to be portable, and also most importantly, it should be accepted as a universal standard of value. But the biggest problem with this bartering system was that the supply and the demand was unlimited, because you could produce unlimited number of cattle and there could be unlimited number of grains. And most importantly, it was perishable. You know, the grains, maybe if there is a rain, the grains would have been destroyed, the cattle would have died and things like that. So people decided that there should be a money which could solve or create a universal value. So they decided in 600 BC, in present day Turkey, you know, they decided to use gold and silver as a form of money. And during these years, you know, as our trade and commerce also grew, right, it was very important to have a universal money which could be accepted across the world. So gold and silver obviously, you know, served this purpose of creating a universal value. So that was one of the best inventions in the humankind. And then, but the biggest problem with this gold and, you know, silver money was basically a portability challenge, right? You know, maybe if I'm carrying a lot of amount of gold and silver, you know, a lot of people might have got killed, might have got theft, and etc. So the movement, it has to be moved physically. So the physical movement became much challenge. And then in China, the Tang Dynasty decided to use a paper form of money. So it was the first time in 1000 AC where you would see bills of exchange started to take place. People started to use bills of exchange for the first time. And in the modern Europe, it became much popular. Because with bills of exchange, you know, people started to rely on certain central parties, maybe the kingdom, maybe the banks, maybe the Medici's in the Europe. So they kind of, you know, became more of, you know, custodian type of a scenario. And this is where the banking, you know, started in Renaissance Italy in around 1400 AD. So Medici's were the first to start a concept of banking where people, you know, could they issued, you know, a lot of bills of exchange in against a lot of deposits. And this started to become a universal form of money, and the paper money started to become more and more popular. The best part about this system of money was that it enabled the trade and commerce to flourish. So the human society in terms of trade, commerce, exchange of cultures, values flourished a lot. Because export import was made easy, you had standard form of money, and this form of money was pretty much accepted anywhere around the world. And as we move, you know, from you know, to more of a government-based system, and you know, dethrone of monarchies, and you know, things like that, we government and British government decided to create a gold standard of money. So, you know, the British government started to create a gold standard for money. So what they used to do is that the government became a custodian of the money, and they started to issue their own currency. The whole idea for this was that even in the United States and even in all the countries around the world, because of there were different governments, there were more than, you know, 100 different types of notes, like gold and silver notes in the US alone. And now the government wanted all the country and all the nation and all the geography to have one single form of money. So the exchange becomes and the track becomes, you know, much, much, much easier. And that's where when the government decided to establish a central bank kind of a system, where central bank became the whole and sole custodian and the issuer of money in against the gold. As we moved, you know, forward because of the technology and more wireless communication system, people realized that, you know, there was need for credit cards and debit cards to move money much faster. You know, and in 1950s, it was the first time in human history where debit card and credit card was used, and it was invented by American Express. And as we moved towards an internet era in 1983, there was online banking concept which flourished, and people started to use online banking for peer-to-peer transactions. And in 2009, you know, blockchain, Bitcoin was discovered as a new form of money, which was purely based on blockchain. Now, this Bitcoin as a form of money had almost everything. The best part about Bitcoin is that you don't need to have a bank account. You don't need to do any KYC or anything. It is a uniform standard of money, and there is no middleman when I talk about of moving money. Let's say if I have to send you money, I could just send you instantly, directly, and at the lowest of the cost possible because of the technology behind it, which is blockchain. So the blockchain success story has been proved with the invention of Bitcoin. Now, you know, connecting this with Libra. So Libra is based almost on the similar values of creating a global financial infrastructure. So moving money around the world should be as cheap and efficient as sending a text message, and no matter where you live and what you do. And it is purely mobile based. It is stable because it is backed by a reserve of currencies and other investment instruments around the world. And it is fast. So this stable problem of money, you know, a lot of African countries and underdeveloping countries have this biggest problem where their money is, you know, not stable, and even central bank cannot do much around it because of their economic situations. So Libra says that if everybody has this access of stable money and a global money, you know, the challenges across these countries could be solved to a lot of extent. So it is made for the world, by the world, and it is scalable because of the blockchain, and also most importantly, security. So as you understand, when a cash has to move physically or money has to move physically, you know, there are still a lot of frauds happen. Your credit card gets hacked, and you know, a lot of other things, you know, which happens. So blockchain could prevent to a lot of extent. because it could be in a track. So coming to the Libra blockchain, so I would just like to, play a quick video for you guys to understand how, a blockchain works and what is a Libra blockchain. Right. So Libra blockchain is basically, it is based on Byzantine fault tolerance. So Byzantine fault tolerance is based on an assumption that, let's say, even one third of the people tries to corrupt the network or tries to do any kind of a fraud, they cannot do because they are rest 66%, which is who are basically honest. So this is based on a belief is that everybody across the network is, honest, and they would do their best to make sure that the blockchain, serves the purpose of trust. And it is based on proof of stake, meaning is that the node validators or person who would verify the transaction is selected based on the stake. So meaning to process every block or every transaction across a blockchain, you need to basically stake your money to process a block. So the person with the highest stakes would be determined to, select and verify the transaction and the block to the blockchain. The whole idea behind is that, a person who is putting more stake to verify the transaction would make sure that the transaction and the network is secured, because he wouldn't want to do a fraud. Because if he has any intention of manipulating the network, he would end up losing all his money and things like that. So it is based on proof of stake. And so biggest challenge. So there are two types. There are basically three, four popular types of consensus algorithm, right? So one is proof of work, which is Bitcoin and present day Ethereum. The other is proof of stake, and then you have delegated proof of stake, right? So these are the most popular consensus mechanisms. And, with all of these, there is obviously issue of, scalability, right? So Libra blockchain uses a Merkle tree and a state channel and sharding architecture. So Merkle tree is, as the name suggests, it is basically dividing sharding and all these state channels, a process of dividing. So let's say in a block, I'm processing 100,000 transactions. So processing 100,000 transactions at a time would require time. And traditionally, there would be some latency, or, they cannot be 100% guarantee rate, right? Even if you use credit card, a lot of time, we see this issue of our transactions not being processed or being bounced. That is because of some network congestion, or maybe that is because of some latency, or maybe some because of any of the technical issues. So what Libra blockchain has does is that they have created a state channel sharding, meaning they divide the transactions into multiple state channels. So let's say they have to process 100,000 transactions, and they are like, maybe 1,000 miners or 1,000 node validators. So they would divide the transaction based on the speed. So let's say there might be some node, which might be underutilized. So under sharding, they want to make sure that the transaction is divided and all the nodes and are optimum utilized, are utilized fully. So they share and the network throws a transaction to everyone to kind of verify and validate. And the other node validators, every node validator across the network would kind of play a key role in validating the transaction, adding it to the block. And based on the Merkle tree, so the Merkle tree is something which would have the entire trail of the transactions and the entire block of the transactions. So any transaction added to the new block can also be verified, taking the references of the previous block based on the Merkle tree architecture. So this is how Libra is planning to scale its blockchain. So in very simple sense, they want to divide the transactions into multiple state channel and spread it across the network so everybody can kind of verify and add the transaction, resulting in higher scalability. Right. And it is based on Move programming language. This programming language is a combination of Golang and Java. And this is solely developed for Libra. And all the transactions in Libra blockchain are also irreversible and immutable. Right. So this is a key difference between a proof of work and a proof of stake, right? So to add each block to the chain, miners need to solve basically a difficult puzzle using their computers as a processing power. So think of proof of work as mining gold on the internet, right? So if you have to mine gold physically, you need to kind of dig big gold and then you find some sand and something and then you dry and you process it and that's how the gold is created, right? So proof of work is also almost a similar thing. It's just the only difference is that you need to, solve mathematical algorithm and puzzle as soon as a transaction is generated on a Bitcoin blockchain. So this has some, hashing and cryptographic puzzles, which all the miners need to solve. So cryptographic puzzles might be something like, 1 plus X is equal to 2. So what is this X? But in a very, very complicated scenario, the algorithms and puzzle could be, much, much advanced like, and it would require some lot of computational power to kind of, verify. So the job of a miner is to basically verify the blocks, to verify the transaction, solve this puzzle, and the solution is broadcasted to everyone. So they could just find this value of X and approve it. So a person who would, the first person who would solve this kind of a puzzle is rewarded for their work. And in Bitcoin blockchain, the complexity, or I would say, just kind of, let me put this way, the network difficulty has reached basically some beta hash. So just let me show you a quick thing. So this is a Bitcoin a blockchain. So you could see the block height, the block hash, and everything. And then this is your data and a block explorer, right? So just let me put Bitcoin difficulty, Bitcoin network difficulty, and you would be able to see where the network difficulty in terms of mining stands, right? So this is the difficulty chart. So as you can see, the Bitcoin network or a Bitcoin blockchain has, a biggest computational infrastructure, I would say, and the network difficulty has reached in some, even trillions and, in zillions, and it has been growing constantly. Meaning, even if a one particular miner, so this is the current Bitcoin difficulty, I can't even read it. So meaning, a particular miner, if he puts more and more computational power to verify the block or a transaction, the block reward is fixed, meaning a miner is incurring a higher cost for verifying the transaction because they have to invest into electricity, into the computation infrastructure. So whatever the block reward, which is around 212 and a half Bitcoin, which is set in the Bitcoin blockchain, is spread proportionately according as per the contribution to the network. So this is the network difficulty, and this is going to grow more. And 7 days it has grown by 5%, 30 days 16%, and 90 days more than 60%. So meaning more and more people are there mining Bitcoin, more and more people are making sure that the network is more and more secure. So with more miners and more people being added to the network, actually the blockchain becomes more and more secure. Because with every new block added to the blockchain system, there's a new hash and a new cryptographic, public-private key kind of a scenario which is generated to make sure the network is more secure. And coming to the proof of stake, there is no competition. As I told you, as a block creator, is basically chosen by an algorithm based on the stake. So in proof of work, it is purely the person, the winner is the person who would verify the transaction and solve that mathematical puzzle. Whereas in proof of stake, the person, the winner is the one who puts more stake to verify the particular block or to put more stake to become a block validator. So in order to have a malicious block attack, they have to own 51% of all the cryptocurrency in a network in proof of stake. Whereas in proof of work, if someone has to do a malicious block, they need to have 51% mining power to hack the network or to manipulate the network. So let's say in a Bitcoin blockchain, whatever the computational power or the network difficulty we have seen, a person needs to own a 51% to kind of create a malicious block, and there is no reward for making a block, so the block creator takes a transaction fee. Whereas in proof of stake, the entire compensation for the miner is only the transaction fee which is there in the block. So it's just basically purely based on a blockchain system where a miner would put his higher stake and would bid for the lowest transaction fee. So the one with the best offer on the table would be selected as a node validator to, you know, kind of verify the block and proof of stake. So Libra is based on the following fundamental beliefs, as I mentioned. Number one belief is that with many more people. So as we have seen in the problem statement, that there are over 1.7 billion people who still have access to zero bank account. And they believe that everybody should have access to the financial services and also to cheap capital. They also believe is that, they have an inherent right to control the fruit of their legal labor, meaning any labor, kind of working around the world should have a stable form of money. Their money should not, get devalued, and they shouldn't be become, poor. It is basically, it is based on an idea of economic equality. They also believe that, the world needs a global, open, instant and low cost movement of money will create immense economic opportunity and more commerce across the world. And also people have started to trust decentralized form of governance, because we have seen so with a lot of centralization, right? Today we trust Facebook, as a social network, and Facebook has the largest people data repository in the world. And this centralized form of governments like Facebook, Google, Amazon, Microsoft, they have started to use data maybe for bad or maybe for manipulation, right? We have seen so much scams like Facebook Analytica scams, Facebook manipulating the elections, playing with psychology of people and, things like that. Even with the money, we have seen a lot of central banks and even banks committing to a lot of frauds. Like best example is 2008 economic crisis, and also a lot of countries getting bankrupt because of some central bank's decision and things like that. So the people's faith in the government, the people's faith in centralization has started to reduce, and they believe is that decentralization is the way to go, because decentralization is for the people, by the people, and most importantly it is governed by the community, right? And they also believe is that the global currency and the financial infrastructure should be designed and governed as a public good. And most importantly, Facebook as a company and Libra as an organization have a responsibility to advance financial inclusion, support ethical factors, and uphold the integrity of the ecosystem. So this is the belief where the Libra blockchain is based. And based on these beliefs, they have decided to use, they have created the Libra blockchain. So this is just a brief architecture on how a transaction flow would work in a Libra blockchain. So you have a node or validator, and you have a transaction, so every block would contain following things. One is basically your epoch ID, which is your block ID, block height, and things like that. The RAM, which is your block number. The node time is basically the timestamp or the network time of the network. The block hash are all your hash values, which is created when the transaction is published onto the network. This is a public and a private key cryptography, and an author and a signature. So a signature, there are two signatures. The one who basically creates the transaction, and the other signature is the one who verifies the transaction, the author. So the person who would identify the consensus. So this is how the Libra, blockchain would work, right? And most importantly, we all might have some common doubts related to the Libra currency and the reserve, and how the overall Libra ecosystem would work. So number one is that Libra says that their currency is more stable because they are backed by a group of currency baskets. So there is, let's say if you take a United States dollar, right, it is backed by a central bank's trust, maybe some oil, maybe some gold, maybe whatever it is. And let's say if you take an Indian rupee, right, it is also backed by a central government or the government bonds. But what Libra says is that they will be backed by a global asset of currency, maybe US dollars, maybe rupees, maybe some percentage of euros, pounds, and some golds, and also to a lot of extent by government bonds and debts. So they believe that, diversifying the risk might result in low volatility, and any person can buy the Libra exchange. So let's say if you want to buy a Libra currency, as per the white paper, you could just go to a bank, maybe pay some US dollars or something based on the Libra currency price, and then you can have hold to Libra. So how it would work, I have got some screenshots of the wallet, so we'll see it as we move further. So Libra's blockchain is open source, so all their codes and everything is available on GitHub. You could just go to the Libra website and go to the developers section where you could find all the details related to their API, the blockchain, and how it works, and they have all the documentations here. So you could just go there and have a quick idea about how their blockchain is work and scalable. So right now, you know, Libra as an association, if you the Libra members are more of big enterprise and corporates, and there are certain prerequisites which I'm going to show you. So the Libra right now at present is more of a centralized, because only with big powerful financial institutions with higher muscle power can be a Libra member and can be their node validator. But eventually they say that they want to, you know, make it more decentralized, so anybody could become a node validator. So overall, their blockchain as a tech is very scalable because of their architecture, and stable because of the money system, right? Because of the financial backing of the Libra tokens. So this is how the Libra Association and the Libra blockchain would work. So the Libra blockchain would be governed by a Libra Association. So they have partners right from your e-commerce to big financial institutions to your Visa, MasterCard payments, and also some crypto exchanges where, you know, one could buy Libra. So to become a Libra member, you need to have basically at least a market cap or a valuation of around $1 billion, or you need to, or an entity need to held at least $500 million in public deposits. So, you know, this shows that the Libra Association and the Libra blockchain right now is more of a centralized, and is only for entities having higher muscle power. Unlike Bitcoin or any other blockchain where anybody could become a part of the network without any prerequisites. So these are the founding, you know, members of the Libra Association, but they say that, you know, they would make it, as I told you, you know, more decentralized in coming years. But I do not, you know, kind of think so, because Facebook and all these companies have been always, you know, around news of, you know, controlling and establishing a monopoly and, you know, things like that. So it's still too early to say that how would Libra blockchain would work. And there has been a lot of resistance, you know, if you have been following the news, from a lot of regulators in the US and the Europe stating that, you know, they cannot allow Facebook to control this kind of monopoly. And so basically, here are the responsibilities of all the members in the Libra blockchain. So the governance, implementation, and strategy. So when we talk about the governance, every member, irrespective of their membership fee and their stakes in the Libra system, will have one member is equal to one vote. And all the members participate in the key decisions about the Libra blockchain, its future implementation roadmap, and how. And also they would actively participating in the implementation of the blockchain, not only by being the validator nodes, but also by making sure the strategy which they have decided and the vision is, you know, come to life with right set of management, with right set of people involved in the ecosystem. So also they, as an organization, or they share a common set of values, and they want to make sure that they are fair and equal to everyone. So this is how it is work. And now coming to a point, how the Libra would work. So Libra, so would have a mobile wallet, maybe something like your Paytm and PayPal, which is Calibra, and the Facebook has the only monopoly for creating the Calibra wallet. So this is a digital wallet, they say, for connected world. And this would be integrated all across the Facebook's ecosystem. So this could be more like PayPal for Facebook or Paytm for Facebook. So let's say if you want to kind of, you know, send or request money, or let's say if you want to send $100 to your friend. So what you could do is that you need to buy Libra. So to buy Libra, first you can go to any of Libra partners or the Libra banks and give them the fiat money of the choice. So the value of a Libra is based on currency to currency, country to country, and geography to geography. So in this scenario, they have shown that the Libra is slightly more expensive than the US dollar, they because of the fact that they are backed by a global pool of currency. So one Libra is equal to, you know, 1.0493 US dollar as per this example. So I'm assuming that the Libra would be 5-6% more you know, pricier than the US dollar. So let's say if you want to, you know, send money from Sofia to Eddie, so Sofia will put how much amount of US dollars he needs to send to Eddie. So let's say 100 US dollars, Eddie will receive 95.31 Libra, and he could just put in Eddie's name, and Eddie would receive the money. And they can be able to cash out or use it directly in Libras, or maybe they can use it via their credit card, debit cards, with MasterCards, Visa. He could cash out in any local currency. So the overall movement of money, you know, the international movement of money has become much easier. So, you know, Sofia from US is able to send Eddie in Mexican pesos in just real time, in just quick few seconds with the power of blockchain. So this is how it would work. And you could also cash out by through banks or through any of the Libra partners. So this is the conclusion, is that number one, as I told you, it's biggest questions on decentralization, because it is still more of a centralized, because it is controlled by big entities and it's not easy to become a Libra member. Those say they say that they would want to open the membership to everyone and would want to have more and more node validators down the line, but it's still too early to say how it's going to go. The other is the biggest is the regulatory and the privacy challenges, because the Facebook and a lot of the other companies associated with and around Libra has been, in the news for some wrong reasons and have done a lot of other scams and, you know, things like that in the past. You know, like and Cambridge Analytica scams and Facebook's manipulating for elections and things like that. So there's a lot of regulatory and privacy challenges. The government feels and the banking system feels that it could be a biggest threat to existing financial system, because it is kind of, you know, monopolizing the financial system. Just to put this way, that today Facebook, you know, serves more than 2 billion people around the world. And now imagine Facebook becoming a bank, or becoming a bank, it will be the world's largest bank, serving 2 billion people and holding money for 2 billion people would make them potentially the entire, you know, monopolist or a monopoly around the world. So a lot of government feel that it could be the biggest threat because of their nature of their business and what, and based on their past records. And I also feel a bit, you know, personally in this way, is that because they need to be a bit controlled. So, I mean, anyways, there have been a lot of, I would say, you know, restriction for Libra blockchain to go live and get them regulatory clearances. So they have moved to Switzerland, and they have established their base in Switzerland, because Switzerland seems to be fair to Libra and welcoming Libra because of its open banking system. Still, European Union and a lot of other countries around the world has been, you know, opposing Libra. So this is a quick conclusion about Libra. If you have any other queries or any doubts, you can reach out to us. And also, you know, just let's say, I mean, if you're interested to know more about the blockchain news, and if you're a cryptocurrency trader, you could use snapupus.com. This is our media arm, which is more like a Bloomberg for your blockchain and, you know, cryptocurrency world. We show you a lot of news around it and a lot of analysis. If you're a regular trader, you could see what crypto to buy and sell based purely on analytics. So we compare the price of every cryptocurrency across multiple exchanges around the world. So you could use our analytics section. And also, this webinar was brought to you by Indian Blockchain Institute.com. So Indian Blockchain Institute is another arm which is purely focused on creating the vibrant blockchain community. So you could, you know, sign up for our next upcoming webinars. We have put all our webinars here, so you can just go to Indian Blockchain Institute and sign up. And also, if you're looking forward to kind of build your career in blockchain, we offer you know, international standards live training program with best of the blockchain faculty. So this is the only blockchain certification program, one of the only few programs which is in aligned with the international standards of Phoenix Foundation and Hyperledger. So our program, you know, gets you up to get certified by Hyperledger, and we help you to get Hyperledger certified. So you could write global job opportunities and you could become a renowned blockchain expert. And also we offer a lot of other kinds of certification, various kind of certification programs for corporates, working professionals, students. We have programs catering to all the category of audience, and our entire curriculum and the entire program modules and the features is everything is kind of, you know, mentioned there. So we cover right from blockchain intro to in-depth to Hyperledger practicals and projects. And this is the only program in the space which is purely backed by a blockchain company. So any other program you go is either by some trainers or some XYZ, and the content and the curriculum is absolutely outdated. We at IBIU want to make sure that our content and the curriculum is at par with the international standards and also at par with the right technological advancement. So we keep on updating our program, we keep on adding more and more practical projects. And most importantly, the entire faculties are, you know, blockchain developers, experienced blockchain developers, and, you know, this is where this is coming from. So any other doubts or queries, let's have a quick Q&A. Thank you so much, everyone. You could please, put all your queries in the chat box and I'll be happy to answer. And in case for any doubts or any queries, you can reach me at prashant.surana@snapperfuturetech.com, and also I'll be happy to help. Okay, guys. So I'm assuming that, you know, I was a bit clear about this and there's no doubts and queries about it. So I'll be signing off. Okay, guys, so I'll have Nishad from our team to kind of, you know, send you across the feedback form. So please do kindly fill in the feedback form and, you know, let us know if we can, you know, create a better webinar experience, and we would be glad to do that. And also please do sign up for our next upcoming webinars as well. So thank you, everyone. Thank you so much. It was really glad to have you all. Take care. Bye. Thank you.